So, hello. Welcome to my presentation on the topic Security Features for UBIFS. My name is Richard Weinberger. I'm co-founder of Sigma Star GmbH and do a lot of kernel and Linux consulting, mostly in the area of low-level stuff and security. And as the topic says, today I'm talking about security features on UBIFS, namely encryption and file authentication. So, first of all, what kind of encryption mechanisms do we already have on Linux? On kernel level, we have the well-known dmcrypt, we have the little bit older cryptoloop, we have ecryptfs, and these days we have fscrypt, which I will talk later more on. In user space, we have encryptfs and veracrypt. It is the fork of truecrypt, and in Linux it is implemented in user space. So this is what we currently have. And now let's dig into it a bit deeper. Dmcrypt and Cryptoloop both work on top of locked devices. That's the first no-go for UBIFS, because on the raw NAND layer, we don't have locked devices. So in Dmcrypt, each block on the storage is encrypted, but always with the same key. That's one of the most weak points of dmcrypt, that you're reusing the key all the time. But the good thing is, since it's working on the block layer, namely the layer below the file system, every single bit of the file system is encrypted. But of course, if you really, really want to, you can also use it on MTT when you stack a container file on a UBIFS, and then you loop mount it using the dmcrypt, and then mount a block file system on top of it, like X2, it kind of works. I have seen this in the wild. But I would not recommend it. Then, also heavily used is ecryptfs. It's a stacked file system. That means you have your regular file system, such as butterfs or X4, and you overmount ecryptfs on top of it, and ecryptfs then does decryption and encryption of each file. The good thing is about it, it has one key per file. That means when the encryption key is broken for one file, then you still have only the key of one file. Besides of file contents encryption, it does also encrypt the file names, but of course not the file metadata. So just the file contents and the file name. On Linux, file system stacking can be problematic, mostly because of performance reasons and memory pressure. In the case of ecryptfs, each file content would be twice in the page cache, one time encrypted and one time unencrypted. And on low power devices, as used for UBIFS, memory usually matters and you don't want that overhead. But it is perfectly usable on UBIFS, and many people are using it. So there's one solution that is OK. So next slide. Then, as I said before, we have encryptfs and veracrypt. These run in user space, also work on top of locked devices. But that's usually not what you want on your embedded system. I have never used them on an embedded device. Maybe it works like charm, but I doubt it. So now on fscrypt. It's rather new. It aims to be the successor of ecryptfs. It offers more or less the same feature set, but with far less overhead. It was added to X4 some time ago, I think it already 1 year ago, and the encryption feature is directly implemented in the file system. So you don't need the stacking of ecryptfs, and you don't have that much overhead. But in fscrypt, you have for each directory a policy, and then you can encrypt also subdirectories. So you don't have to encrypt the whole file system tree. You can have multiple encryption for multiple directories. The main use case was Google Android and Chrome OS. For example, in Chrome OS, that the home directory from each user is encrypted. So, first, when I thought about adding encryption to UBIFS, I thought it would be a good idea to implement something like DMcrypt for MDD. It shouldn't be a big thing, just add a new pseudo MDD device that sits between UBIFS and the real MDD, and it should do more or less the same like DMcrypt does. But the downside is you have then again one single key for the whole MDD, so you don't have a key per file, or no, better, per inode. Then there are small corner cases. For example, on NAND, you have to deal with empty pages, so you must not encrypt all the FF bytes and write them down. That would be a problem. Then again, stacking. When I add a new MDD layer, then the stacking is deeper. So on a second thought, it just didn't feel right, and I dropped that idea again. Then I finally concluded that it would be a good idea to implement it using FS Crypto. Before that, it was called FS Crypto, and now it's called FS Crypt, so I always mix it up. Now, a brief history on FS Crypt. As I said, it was a feature of X4. It was added in 4.1. Its use case was replacing DMcrypt in Android N and get more flexibility. For example, you can encrypt each home directory or each application directory. Then it was still part of X4. Then later the F2FS guys thought it would be a good idea to support file encryption too, and then they copy-pasted the X4 crypto stuff in their tree, and then I asked on the mailing list whether it would be a good idea when I do a third copy. Then they said, no, let's do it in a generic way, and then it got moved out into the FS crypto subdirectory, and now it is a generic framework where you can implement FS crypt for your file system. So now a little bit more on the features. As I said, you can apply on each directory a policy. This policy describes with what key and with what cipher modes every single subdirectory and subfile is being encrypted. And you load a master key for each policy, and then for each inode from the master key, a new key is derived. So we have for each file a new key. That makes the attack vector using recreate attacks much harder. And the master key is provided by user space using the keys kernel subsystem. Maybe you don't know it. The kernel has a subsystem that is called keys. It's a really huge subsystem where you can manage encryption keys and also generic keys. You can load a key from user space, and then you can define which threads or other users are able to use that key in what way. And FSCrypt is using this framework, and there's a system call, it's called key control, and there's also a user space tool, it's also called key control, where you can query, update, and manage your keys. One interesting property of FSCrypt is that it also works when the key is not present. So when you do a read directory on an encrypted directory and you don't have the key, then you still get a directory listing, but you see only the encrypted file names. And with proper permissions, you're even allowed to unlink that files. The use case is rather simple. On Google Chrome OS, you want the sysadmin being able to delete a user home directory even when you don't know the password. That's where this feature came from. And this little feature made it for UBIFS really hard, but I will explain later in much more detail. So, and also a good thing is we have XFS tests for FSCrypt. And we found really a lot of issues between UBIFS, X4, and F2FS, where they all implemented FSCrypt in a little different way. For example, we have new return codes, for example, E no key. So when you try to read a file where you don't have the key, then the file system returns E no key. But it could also return E access, E perm, and whatever. And it would be a good thing when all file systems would return the same value. Otherwise, they confuse user space in horrid ways. As I said, we have for each node a new key. Much more better than using a single key here. The downside is currently only file contents are encrypted, not the metadata. That also means not the extended attributes. We could add this, shouldn't be a big deal, but we should get a general consensus. I can do it for UBIFS, but then X4 should also do it, and also F2FS. So it should be defined what to do. And no identification of data, but I will talk later on that in much more detail. By default, F-Crypto just supported AES 25256 in XTS mode, and for file names in ciphertext stealing mode. This works perfectly fine for the Google use case, but didn't in my embedded use case, because on the small, low-power devices, doing AES in XTS mode has to be done in software, and it's really slow. So we added a new mode, 128 CPC ASIF mode, because this can be offloaded to most hardware offloaders you have on the embedded devices, for example, on the Freescale common devices or Atmel. And then the encryption is reasonably fast. I hope that there will be support for more cipher modes soon, but currently we have only these two. So as I said, file name encryption. Usually when you have a string and you encrypt it, then the result of the encryption is not a string, it's just binary gibberish. When readdir and lookup get binary, they won't be very happy. For example, when your ls tool in the command line returns binary, that's not a good thing. So FScript encodes the file name is in base 64, in base 64. When you don't have the key, that works perfectly fine. But encoding something in base 64 bloats the string, because you're only using 7 bits instead of 8 bits. And now guess what will happen when I have a file name that has already the maximum supported file name length, and I'm in trouble. For example, EcryptFS ignores that use case and it's just truncating the file name. When you have a file name that is too long, it just doesn't work. In FScript, they decided no. Then we represent to the user a cookie, and then during lookup time, we don't use the file name, we use the cookie. Because reader is supposed to return a cookie and everything is fine. Then a little bit more on the user space API. It is actually rather simple. We have just two I/O controls. These I/O controls are per file system where I can get and receive the policy. So you can open a directory on your X UBIFS or F2FS and then run that I/O control to apply a policy. And you can also read the policy back to double check whether it works. And then we have the key control system call where you can load the master key and everything works fine. The key has to be type of log on. This is an interesting property I will tell later more about. And usually it's a logon key in your session key ring. They're using the logon key because user space can only set it but not read it back. There are many tools how to deal with FScript. The oldest one is E4Crypt. It's just a testing tool for X4. It also works only with X4. There's FScript. It's a really large one and written in Go. For example, it does also a key declaration for you. Usually, using the kernel interface, you load the raw key into, so the kernel doesn't care what you load. And FScript, the tool, derives from your bus trace or your whatever key, the master key. But since it's written in Go, it's rather large and for the embedded use case, not really suitable. So there's also a tool, it's called FScript Control. It's written in C and rather minimal. That can be used on the embedded use case or just do your own. We have written such tools in 100 lines of C code, so it's really not a big deal. usually you run it in the initial RAM disk where you just have nothing. And I hope that we get such a tool sooner or later in BusyBox. Maybe I do it myself, depends on my time. And now finally, UBIFS support. It was done by David and me. It's in since 4.10. Of course, it was much more work than I expected. We had to change UBIFS and FFscript, and now we'll go in detail what happened to us. So usually, UBIFS internally assumes that file names are strings. When, as I said, when I encrypt a string, then the result is no longer a string, it's just binary. Now we had to change UBIFS to deal with the fact that the stored file names are no longer strings. And it was much more work than just search and replace, because there are many, many places in UBIFS that assumed implicitly that it is a string. For example, there are places where it just randomly assigns a null bind, because it's being a string and there has to be a null byte. And we had to find all these places. Then the hugest part was cookie support for redo. UBIFS has only support for 32-bit hashes. That's usually not a big deal, because when you face a hash collision, you can just do a string compare and find the real hit. But with FScripto, when I don't have the key, I get from redo the cookie, and then I have to do the full lookup just with the cookie. That's why we had to extend the internal hash by another 32 bits to get a larger hash where we don't collide. And a byproduct was now we have proper secdir and LD support and being able to do export FS and proper kernel NFS support. The solution was, when we compute the 32 bits hash, then we just apply another 32 bits random number, and that way we get a long enough hash value. We could also have used a second hash function, but it doesn't really matter. For example, X4 does double MD4. It's just a matter of taste. It doesn't make the hash much better. Another small thing for the whole FScript subsystem was designed for X4 and assumed that all I/O paths are like the X4 I/O path, and UBIFS works slightly different, and so we had to teach FScript that not everything deals with BIOS. And now we have a second I/O path in FScript that deals with plain buffers. Now, how can you use this encryption feature in UBIFS? It's actually rather easy. Just enable the config option, config UBIFS, FS encryption. Then using one of the tools I manage, apply a policy to a directory. You can also apply it to the root directory to encrypt the whole file system root. That's actually the main use case. And then when you run Linux, then you have to load the master key. Usually, you do this in the initial RAM disk when the whole root file system is encrypted, or when it's just the home directory using PAM during the logon. That's all. We even have support for MKFS, but I didn't have the time yet to clean up the patches and push them to the mailing list. But there is a patch, then you can create a properly encrypted UBIFS image with the MKFS tool. So you don't have to build the root FS during runtime. Now I will show you a few pitfalls. They are all just made up. I never fell into them. What usually is a problem. For example, when we have two users on our system, foo and bar, and the user bar has a secret file, it is being encrypted, then foo can still be able to read that file. Namely, when bar loaded his key and read this file, and foo has the Unix permissions to read that file, then the file is in the D entry cache, so we get the file name, and this is also in the page cache, we get the contents. And this is something you have to keep in mind. That means even when you encrypt the home directories using FScript, you still have to set up proper permissions. This can be confusing. Or even better, during logon time, create for each home directory a new private mount point, a new private mount namespace, so that the mount is completely hidden. It depends on your setup. Then, one thing that hit us really hard is the BAM keyinit module. Usually, the session keying is being shared across all processes. It works perfectly fine, but there's a BAM module that is enabled by many distros by default. When you log in, then this module creates a new login session and creates also a new login key ring, a session key ring. Sorry, it's a key type of type login and a key ring of type session. And this module creates a new session key ring. That means suddenly the new logged in user is not being able to use the key, and all files are no longer readable. This is a main problem in EtherScript and is also known to the EtherScript maintainers. There's the idea to create a new keyring type, especially for EtherScript, or just drop the keys support in general and use I/O control. It doesn't matter. We will see what the outcome is, but currently just disable this BAM module. There's also an interesting deadlock. Namely, when the whole root file stem is encrypted and in your initial RAM disk you do the key setup and do a switch route, then system can deadlock. It can deadlock because of the following reason. Up on first access of, for example, modprop, oh, there's a typo, it should be off, of the first file access of modprop, then the I/O path goes to the EtherScript code. And of course, when the root file system is being encrypted, then modprop needs decrypted first. Then we go into the EtherScript path, where it is requesting the ciphers. The cipher request goes into the crypto subsystem. The crypto subsystem sees, oh, we have AES, awesome, but maybe there's a better AES implementation. Let's ask modprop again. Then while decrypting modprop, we call modprop for decrypting modprop, and it will deadlock. But the workaround is rather simple. Just make sure that before first access, you load that ciphers. A workaround is starting the modprop file in the new path before you switch route, and the issue is gone. And the interesting fact is also that this happens also when all crypto modules are built in. But we've reported the problem, and it's known, and there is even a patch to get this fixed. But I bet you will use it on slightly older kernels and backport it, so keep this in mind. And there's another problem. For file name encryption, EtherScript is using the ciphertext stealing mode. There's a special encryption mode for AES where the result of the decryption is always equally long than the input. Because for file names, we don't want to pad to the next block size. So we use ciphertext stealing. This mode is rather uncommon and not that often used. And we found that a common driver had a bug. And it didn't work, but it was fixed. And I think 2 weeks ago, someone reported me that UBI encryption doesn't work on his platform. And then we found out he's using the Atmel crypto offloader. And this driver had the same bug. So if your file names are suddenly in Klingon, please retry without the offloaders. I bet there are much more drivers broken. We have, in the crypto subsystem, a test case for that. But to run the test case, you need the hardware. So that was on file encryption. This already is in mainline and works as expected. Now we'll talk a little bit more about file identification. And these are things that are not really mainline. But first, we need to ask us, when we talk about identification, what do we really want to be authenticated? Usually, you have some strange compliance paper. It says, encrypt your files and authenticate them. But what does this mean? Does this mean just the file contents, also the attributes, for example, the timestamps or extended attributes, also the directory structure? So maybe when two files are properly signed, can you swap them? Do you want to have the whole file stem authenticated, or even the storage? it depends on the use case, but everyone talking about that means something different. So there's no general consensus. Currently, we have on Linux, as I know, three possible solutions. Maybe there are more, but I think it's just three. There's the Integrity Management Measurement Architecture, IMA. This is a system where you can sign your file contents and store that signature in the extended attributes. And when the file was changed without updating the signature, you will notice. Then we have two solutions on the block layer, DM Integrity and Verity. DM Integrity is rather new. It works in combination with DMCrypt, and it stores, besides of the encrypted block, a hash value, an HMAC for each block, and it can find out when blocks have been changed without having the key. The downside, you need for each block an extra few bytes to store that HMAC. Then we have Verity. It works, as far as I know, only on read-only storage devices. So first of all, let's look at the DM solutions. As I said, device mapper assumes a block device, so we cannot really use it on MDD. Okay, we can stack, but that's not so good. But we can use IMA on UBFS, and it needs a few small patches. So thanks to Sasha and Oleski from Pangotronics for sending me these patches. You were faster than me with fixing that. So this works rather well, but IMA has a few downsides. For example, you can still sign a file, but file swapping is not always being detected. And I think write support is also rather slow. So my plan is, or dream, is having the whole authentication done in FSCrypt, such that UBIFS can use it in a generic way. Because we want also file identification on X4 or ButterFS. So I'm really not a fan of an ad hoc solution. Having file identification was actually one of the goals of FSCrypt, but it didn't really materialize. They just added encryption, and nothing more happened. So we could use, for example, AES Goliath counter mode to have file contents encrypted and authenticated. That's easy. Okay, it's not that easy because it will bloat the file length, and then when storing in the write back path, we have to do a different space accounting, but it's still doable. But it's just the file contents. We want something generic also for, at minimum, detect file swapping. So one possible solution is just add an HMAC to each UBIFS node. We have in UBIFS this common header. Each UBIFS node has this common header. And in the UBIFS write path, just sign every file system node, and then we can authenticate the whole system. That's actually easily doable, but it has a few downsides. A reasonably strong HMAC has 64 bytes, and bloating each single UBIFS node by 64 bytes is not really something I want to do. Usually, the UBIFS nodes are rather small, just a few bytes, except for the data nodes. These are larger ones. But this is a bloating I don't want to have. And one downside, we have in UBIFS support for feature flags and different versions. But there's a, let's name it, design anti-pattern. The UBIFS superblock that contains the UBIFS feature flags and versions also contains the common header. And when the common header is suddenly larger, then we have the version field on a different offset. And then in an old UBIFS version will fail badly. Usually, I want to print something like, OK, this is too new. I won't mount it, and not a random oops. But we can add a common footer, for example. As I said, this is a solution I don't want to have mainline. I want something with FSCrypt. One idea is that we use FSCrypt, so we reuse the whole key management, that we just have to load one master key and then derive from that key the encryption keys for the files, and also derive the the keys for the file authentication, and we just sign the UBIFS index tree. Because when the index tree is signed, then we have the whole structure in a secure way and can detect modifications such as file swapping. This idea looks promising, but I need to do a prototype and see what the downsides are. Because when we sign all UBIFS branch nodes, we have to compute a checksum after leaf nodes. And currently, we can add leaf nodes to a branch without rewriting the whole tree. But when we now have the whole branch signed, we have to recompute the checksum, and then we have to rewrite that tree much more often. That means we have to call often the UBIFS commit operation, and it will wear down the flash much more faster. But it needs some testing, and we will see. One thing that's often forgotten is the VFF's integration. For example, when you have a butterfs, and butterfs finds that your file is corrupt, it will just return EIO and write some interesting stuff in a D message. But actually, what I want is a user space interface, and I can ask for the state of a file. Is this file signed and good? And when it's not good, please tell me why. Are there just a few bit flips? Was it replaced? So we need a better interface. And that's something we need to talk with the VFS guys. Maybe we can come up with a common I/O control to query that state. But that's also have to be kept in mind. And for butterfs, we have already checksumming, and this needs to be fixed there too. So that was my presentation on UBIFS crypto and stuff. We have a few minutes left for questions. Are there any? No questions? That's awesome. Yes, and thank you. And if you have questions, I will be around the whole day.